Our guest today is the Speaker of the House for the state of Illinois. He is a dedicated family man who has devoted his entire life, adult life, to public service. Ladies and gentlemen, Mike Madigan. Mr. Speaker.
Thank you for the nice round of applause. Apparently the Chicago Tribune wasn't directing any of you to do what you were doing. I would propose that we do a three-part program. So part one would be my remarks that would set out my view of the current budget impasse in Springfield. The second part would be my view as to where I have attempted to meet the governor halfway as we have worked our way through the budget impasse. And then the third part would be the public participation and the questions. So to begin, in January, at the time of the legislative inauguration, I pledged to Governor Rauner that I would work with him professionally and cooperatively. I've renewed that pledge many times over the last several months. I renew it again today. My pledge to the governor is very simple. I will work with him professionally and cooperatively. The number one problem facing the government of the state of Illinois is the budget deficit. Layered on top of the current budget deficit would be structural deficits which have been carried forward from prior budgets, the unfunded liability in the state pension systems, the aggregate state debt load, and now an announcement by the governor a few weeks ago that he actually plans to borrow for state operations. And this is terribly significant because we're talking about the governor of one of the top five states in the nation who's publicly announcing that he's going to borrow for operations. Now, if you add all of that together, the budget deficit, the structural deficit, the unfunded liability in the pension systems, the aggregate debt load, borrowing for operations, and Illinois is awash in debt. Awash in debt at a time when the governor has publicly committed to spend over 100% of the amount of money that he estimates will be available for the current budget. I don't feel that we can simply cut our way out of the budget deficit problem. The governor filed a cuts-only budget. It was not balanced. It would have cut medical care services for the elderly, the disabled, and struggling families. It would have done more harm than good. My view is that we have to have a balanced approach to solving the problem of the budget deficit. Illinois should cut its spending, and that's precisely what the legislature did when we passed Senate Bill 788, which would reduce spending in the Medicaid program by $400 million. At the same time, Illinois needs new revenue, which is why I have proposed that Illinois impose a surcharge on millionaires for education. In May, the legislature passed a spending plan to the governor. It was a spending plan that would have helped and protected middle-class families by providing support for local schools, local police and fire, and local road programs. In Illinois, under the Illinois Constitution, the governor is given broad veto power. And two elements of the veto power would be the reduction veto and the line item veto. Governor Rauner could have taken the spending plan which we gave him in May. He could have used the reduction veto and the line item veto to fashion that spending plan to his liking. As a matter of fact, he did use the line item veto on House Bill 4166, which was the capital appropriation bill. But as a general proposition, the governor chose to veto the entire budget except elementary and secondary education and the capital bill that I just referenced. That left certain sections of education, like universities and community colleges, with no state funding. The governor argues that we should do changes in workers' compensation, collective bargaining, and the prevailing wage before we finalize the budget. I think it's very interesting at this point to note that when the bond rating agencies critique Illinois finances, and they've done a lot of it in recent years because, you know, on many occasions they've downgraded the credit rating of the state. When the bond rating agencies do their job, they've never talked about workers' compensation, collective bargaining, prevailing wage. It's never an item in their reports. What the bond rating agencies talk about is money in, money out. There's not enough money coming in to pay for the money going out. That's what the bond rating agencies say about the condition of Illinois finances. The governor's advocacy of these non-budget issues, workers' compensation, collective bargaining, prevailing wage, runs contrary to the core beliefs of both Democrats and Republicans, because the governor's advocacy of these issues, workers' compensation, collective bargaining, prevailing wage, would reduce the wages and the standard of living of middle-class families and send injured workers to welfare or to the emergency room. In addition, the governor's advocacy of these non-budget issues takes the negotiations on the solution to the budget deficit problem, which is the number one problem facing the state, to the extreme. It's my judgment that the solution to our number one problem, the budget deficit, does not lie in the extreme. It lies in moderation. Let me now move to the consideration of where we've attempted to meet the governor halfway. You're all familiar that we are at impasse. You hear frequent comment, well, it's several months into the budget, but there is no budget. But the truth is that a huge majority of what the state does has continued on because of court orders, because the governor signed elementary and secondary education. But there's much that remains to be done. So the governor has attempted to advance his non-budget issues. One of them is workers' compensation. The House has passed a bill that would do changes in workers' compensation. The Senate has passed a bill that would do changes in workers' compensation. There could be additional items added to those bills. The bills could be reconciled, sent to the governor for his approval. Senator Cullerton and I have publicly acknowledged that there are changes that could be done and should be done in the workers' compensation system. That's all possible. That could be sent to the governor for his approval. Next. The governor wants to privatize the operations of the Illinois Department of Commerce and Economic Opportunity. This is the Illinois Economic Development Agency. I agree with the governor. I think we ought to try privatization of that particular department. My office worked with his office. We exchanged ideas. We came to an agreement on a bill that would give the governor what he wants. Privatization of that agency. I made one small request, that in the bill there be a provision that there be an automatic review of the operations of the department under privatization after 3 years. We call it a sunset. It's automatic. The way it's written, it compels a review of what has happened under privatization. The reason that I made this request is that there have been efforts to privatize economic development agencies all across the country. And the results are mixed. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't work. Wisconsin is a case in point. Governor Walker wanted to privatize the operations of their economic development agency. They went ahead, they passed the bill, they set up a board to supervise the operations of the department. Under their legislation, Governor Walker became the chairman of the board. Going forward, a company came in before the board, made an application for a grant or a certification for eligibility for a tax break. They got what they wanted, then they made a big contribution to Governor Walker. So it brought on a scandal such that Governor Walker was compelled to advance legislation that would remove him as the chairman of the board. That's just one example of where it didn't work out too well. Sometimes it works well. My position is, let's put ourselves in a position where on an automatic basis, we can review what's happened with this particular privatization. Next. The governor says he wants to freeze real estate taxes. In the Illinois House, on 16 occasions, we have called a bill that would freeze the extension on real estate taxes. When the bill is called, generally about 40 Democrats vote for the bill, close to zero Republicans. Had there been a decent number of Republicans supporting the bill, it would already be over in the Senate many months ago. The governor made a request that the legislature forego an anticipated adjustment in their compensation. We acceded to the governor's request. We moved a bill that suspended the anticipated COLA adjustment. In addition, we provided for a suspension of the reduced level in the per diem account in the travel allowance. The last area where the governor has made a request, and I think that we've done a very good job of responding to the request, takes us into another area, but this is very helpful. It's called appropriations. For those of us in the legislature, we use this word appropriations. The spending by the state government is done by a variety of agencies only after they get the authority to spend from the legislature. That's what we call an appropriation bill. So when I talk about an appropriation bill, I'm talking about an element of the total budget making, which is done by the state of Illinois. So there's three instances here. Number one, when Governor Rauner first took office in January, he complained that the then current budget was not in balance. I agreed with him. I went to my caucus. They weren't real happy. I used that persuasion that the Tribune talks about all the time. And then they got happy. It was amazing. We cooperated with the governor. We sat, we talked, we exchanged ideas. We negotiated, and we sent a bill to the governor, which he signed, and he publicly proclaimed as a real good job. He was real happy that there had been a correction in what we call the FY15 budget. Next, a few months ago, the governor made a request to us, would we appropriate the federal money? So the state of Illinois gets money from the federal government. We spend that money only after we have adopted an appropriation bill that authorizes all the agencies to spend the federal money. Governor's request was, okay, we're at odds, we're at impasse, but let's do the federal money. We did a bill that did the federal money plus some state money from McCormick Place, sent the bill to the governor, he signed the bill. Second example of cooperation. Lastly, this last Monday, the Senate passed a bill that did more appropriations. This particular bill started in the House. It was an initiative of Representative Moylan. It would have provided for an appropriation for, say, the lottery, for local motor fuel tax for local governments, and a variety of items where the state collects the money, but somebody else spends the money. That's how Moylan started. After about a week of consideration of the bill, the governor came along and said, I'd like to include some items in the bill. One of his items provided that the Department of Transportation would be able to buy salt for the winter snow season, at which point our response was, that's a good idea, Governor, but we think we ought to provide for an appropriation for what's called the LIHEAP program, which is money for poor people to pay their energy bills during the winter. It was a nice trade-off. Bottom line, we met, we talked, we exchanged ideas, we got the bill. We sent the bill to the governor signed the bill. Three instances of budget making that happened in the ordinary course, the normal course that we follow in Springfield. One little difference. The governor was not demanding changes in workers' compensation, collective bargaining, prevailing wage. That demand was absent during the consideration of these three bills. And that's where I come back to my point that his advocacy of these non-budget issues, workers' compensation, collective bargaining, prevailing wage, takes our work in Springfield, our effort to solve the number one problem facing the state, which is the budget deficit problem, to the extreme. It doesn't belong in the extreme. It will not be solved in the extreme. It'll be only solved as those three appropriation bills were settled, because everybody is working in moderation. Thank you for being so patient. And Paul, my memory is that you proposed the questions.
Yes, sir.
Coming up. Take it easy on me now.
Okay. We have, if you have a question, not from the media, you'll have your chance maybe later. Our people are out there. Raise your hand, all staff people. There they are. If you have a question, raise it up and one of the people will get it. Okay. First question, showing ecumenical spirit, comes from Phil Hale of Loyola University. Mr. Speaker, would you please expand upon the compromises which you feel you have already made to the governor?
I can go back through that complete list again. You can see I've got it pretty well memorized.
You could just say IBID.
It's the same stuff. And if you let me go, I'm just going to go back over the same items and end with the recommendation that we not do things in the extreme. How about another question?
All right. Good answer. what do you think I'm going to say? Ash and Ladd, what are the two items that are not negotiable, and of the two which you, one would, Ashton, we'll read your question in a second. Dan Schultenberger, you say you are trying to protect the middle class, yet during almost three decades you have been House Speaker, the state has lost jobs and congressional seats. Okay, how can you say that you are protecting the middle class? We leave out the congressional seat. That's sort of based on population. I'll just throw that in, but go ahead. There you go, Mike.
Yeah. This goes right to the heart of the difference of opinion between myself and the governor. And so as part of my remarks, I explained that I feel that his position on certain of these issues would lower wages and the standard of living of middle-class families. And I would follow up by explaining that the history of the American government prior to 1933 was pretty much to remain out of the business of managing the economy. However, beginning in 1933 with the administration of Franklin Roosevelt, there was a dedicated effort by the federal government to, in effect, manage the economy and to work always to create jobs, to raise wages, to raise the standard of living. That is obtained through both Democrat and Republican administrations. That was the policy of the Roosevelt administration for 20 years, and it was followed by Truman. Eisenhower became the president. No change. Same idea, that it's the responsibility of the federal government working through the Congress and the Federal Reserve to, in effect, manage the economy, raise wages, raise the standard of living, work to prevent too much inflation. That's been the policy of the country for all of these years, and that's where I say I don't think any government should be in the business of lowering wages and the standard of living. That the responsibility upon the government is to move in the opposite direction, to do what the government can do and do well, raise wages on a continuing basis, and maintain a good standard of living for everybody in the country.
Here is a little shorter question for you, Mr. Speaker. Dan Lyons-Smith, Chicago Jobs Council. Why are we calling it a budget impasse and not the more accurate term, budget crisis?
You're right. It is an impasse, but it is a crisis because, as I explained earlier, much of what the state does has been happening without regard to the absence of the appropriation bills signed by the governor. Much of what the state does has been happening because of court orders and because the governor signed the elementary and secondary appropriation bill. The crisis will be as a result of the bargaining and the negotiation that happens between the governor and the legislature. So, yes, much of what the government does is happening, but there's much that remains to be done. There's about $6 billion of spending, $6 billion of spending that the state of Illinois has traditionally done. This goes into the social service area, not-for-profits to provide services to the state. Those people are not being funded today. And the danger for them and the danger for the recipients of their services is that they get left out when there's a final settlement between the governor and the legislature. That's the crisis. And it goes directly to my view of what the government should do, the governor's view of what the government should do. He and I at this point have some basic differences. I feel that the government should do what we put into the May spending plan that we sent to the governor. And there's about $6 billion of activity that's not accounted for today.
Lawrence Massal, Civic Federation, frequent speaker here. even tried out to be the moderator. You don't want to have that chance again, I guarantee you. What role should the state of Illinois play in helping to stabilize the Chicago public schools close to their $480 million current operating budget deficit?
Good question. Very controversial question before the legislature, very divisive. My view is that the Chicago school system is the largest school system in Illinois. It's 86% poor children, according to the federal free lunch standard. 86% poor children, 85% minority, 16% English learners. This is a system that needs help. This is a system that deserves help because it's taken on the responsibility to educate children where 86% are poor, 85% are a minority. As we work our way through the negotiations with the governor on a final budget solution, my argument is going to be what I just said. That system deserves special attention, special consideration. If you wish to argue that there can be better administration of the system, fine. Let's sit down and let's talk about that. If there are other changes in teaching methods, let's talk about that. But let's not take the view that we're going to walk away from a state responsibility to educate the poor and the minorities in the state of Illinois. I won't agree to that.
Okay, we have a lot of questions, so hold off. We have... Yeah, you're free for dinner. All right. Kathy Carmody, Public Policy for People with Disabilities. Can you comment on the underfunded system of community services for people with disabilities and what changes you would like to see in this area? Thank you.
This is an example of one of the areas that's really in danger. So I just spoke to this a little bit ago. We have the big items like education, the Medicaid program, and then there are areas like this where it's going to take some real tough negotiating and bargaining in order to provide that those services will continue to be provided by the state of Illinois. I'm not equipped to speak as to what can be done better in those areas. I just know that historically, for 25, 30, 35 years, the state has funded activities like this, and it should continue to fund activities like this.
Wendy Catton. Wendy, where are you? You're a frequent participant. I see you, Wendy. Raise your hand in for Illinois Public Education. Here's the question. Once the budget is figured out, we like positive statements. Would you raise new revenue to bring the school foundation level up to the, is that EFAB? Well, I don't do acronyms. Recommendation of over $8,600 per pupil, more than $2,000 spent now. And then she adds, as she always does, if not, why?
I'm for more support for education. The governor is for more support for education. The question is, how do you get it done? There's a debate now around the legislature concerning the method of distributing the school money to the various school districts all over the state. We call it the school aid formula. It gets terribly complicated, terribly contentious. Translated, that means that there's many, many districts all over the state and they want to know, what am I going to get out of this? And that's how they instruct their legislators to act when they get down to Springfield. I think it's time that we do a good, in-depth review of the distribution of the school money. There's the formula, there's block grants, there's poverty grant, there's a whole variety of methods of distributing the money. We should take a good, hard look at all of that. In the House, we've created a bipartisan group with the support of Representative Durkin, the minority leader, and we've collaborated, Democrats and Republicans, for several months to develop a good knowledge base as to changes that ought to be done. Certain of the Republicans are complaining that the Chicago school system does too well because of something called the block grant. And that's a subject of debate. We don't have to solve that today. But they would say Chicago is getting too much from the block grant. They should lose some of that. It could go to suburban Collier County school districts. That takes you into where you can understand the contention that's going to happen on this particular issue. Bottom line, it's time for a review, and we're already about the business of doing that.
Okay. We have the new University of Illinois Chicago Chancellor. Michael, where are you? And why don't you, for everybody, pronounce your last name? Well done. Okay. You don't get this job because you're slow. Mr. Speaker, has the state run out of money by now for FY16? And if so, what does this mean for higher education? I could answer that one. It's two words, streetwise. No. I'm sorry, Jackie, that's the only one I'll do.
Question I heard, has the state run out of money? I'm not in a position to answer that question with complete accuracy because the answer would be somewhere in the executive department, somewhere in the governor's office, his office, or the Bureau of the Budget. They're right at the heart of money coming in, money going out. There's a remarkable ability in the governor's office and the office of the comptroller to stretch out payments, to tell individuals and groups that are deserving of money from the state, like local governments, the RTA, school districts, vendors, to tell them you're going to have to wait for your money. And as I said, there's a remarkable ability for the governor and the comptroller to stretch out the payments. They're doing that. It was done in the past under prior administrations. Solid question that I put to the governor in one of our meetings. Mr. Governor, would you go back to your people and ask them if they would estimate when do they think that we will not be able to make a school aid payment? We make school aid payments 10 months a year, twice a month. They're big payments. It's a big movement of money out of the Treasury to school districts all over the state. And so to answer your question, that's a good question to put. When do you think you'll run out of the money? Governor Rauner, you know, was a very successful salesman. And you know, salespeople are always upbeat about things. And he came back and said, we don't have any problems. You know, we'll work our way all the way through it. And I said, okay, I don't believe you. But if you have a further answer for me later, let me know. We don't know. That's a key question in terms of forcing people to get reasonable, be moderate, sit down and exchange ideas as we did on those three appropriation bills and solve the bigger problem.
Okay, Mr. Speaker, we have four quick questions left and that'll be it. Thomas McElroy, where are you, Tom? This organization's called?
Level One.
Level One, okay. Can you talk about the minority and women-owned vendors of the state that are not working or being paid?
I spoke to this gentleman earlier before we started, and it's a real problem. And so he's with a company that's providing services to the state. I just spoke to the remarkable ability of the governor and the comptroller to stretch out payments and tell people you have to wait for your money. And so that's happening. And unfortunately, among the victims, the minority firms will be bigger victims than the others because the others will have more ability to carry on until the money comes in the door. It's a serious problem. It's a solid reason why all of this should be solved.
Okay, Ashton, I finally got your question, and Governor, you can take this one as a mulligan because you don't want to negotiate in front of everybody. What would you put on the table? What two items would you put on the table if it meant getting a budget deal done? You could just say whatever you want to say.
Three obvious areas are workers' compensation, collective bargaining, prevailing wage. You see how well I've memorized all of that? Going beyond that, why the governor did ask to privatize the Department of Commerce and Economic Opportunity. The governor has said that he wants to freeze property taxes. Those are four that stand out where you could have serious give and take, serious negotiations, if everybody's being moderate. Stay out of the extreme.
Okay, two more questions. This is from Chris Roebling, who is a treasurer of the City Club, but obviously didn't have a question for him. He gave me this. Using Ed Mazur's name tag. I mean, this is all for one and one for all. Obviously, it's a short question, Mr. Speaker. How high, but it's a sandbag, how high do you think taxes need to go? Maybe one or two word answer could do.
All right, let me avoid creating a headline for tomorrow's newspaper. And say that a good place to begin would be the level we were at before the income tax expired. And starting there, you can go in whatever direction you want to go.
Didn't get that job by luck, did you? Okay, last question. This is from Sean Stott, Laborers Union. Where are you, Sean? You're somewhere here, I assume. That's the good news. The bad news is you're not a member of the City Club. All right. This is a good question to end this. The legislature made significant changes to the workers' comp system in 2011. Medical costs are dropping rapidly, yet the insurance industry did not recommend any rate changes for Illinois business. What role should insurance industry oversight play in changes in the workers' comp system? It's a tough question.
It's a very good question. And it takes us into a very contentious area because, as I've explained, the governor wants changes in workers' compensation. Senator Cullerton and I have told him directly, privately, and publicly, we acknowledge there are changes that could be done in that system to make it better, to make it more efficient, to get money out to injured workers on time so they're not taking loans to support their family. We did do a bill that changed workers' compensation in 2011. The evidence from that bill, in part substantiated by the Illinois Workers' Compensation Commission, which is under the control of the governor, is that the bill is working. Costs are coming down. That doesn't mean that the Illinois costs are at a level with Indiana or Wisconsin, because the system is predicated upon wage levels. If you're injured on the job and you prove your case, the award is a percentage of your wage. And so the wage levels in Illinois are higher than they are in Indiana and Wisconsin. And so if you want to bring down the cost, some people would say, bring down the wage levels. I don't sign up for that program. But the evidence is costs are coming down. We're showing improvement. 2011 was a tough bill. A lot of time went into it, and it passed on a contentious roll call in the House of Representatives. It was all Democrats that voted for the bill to reduce benefits and workers' compensation.
How about a round of applause? Hold on, Mike.